As I said in the introduction to today's show, we are at a crucial juncture in the struggle to stop the U.S. Supreme Court from overturning the right to abortion. Today was also a day of action called by Rise Up for Abortion Rights. And right now, we're going to show you just a couple of social media posts of this struggle.
Rise Up for Abortion Rights youth walkout. Look at this. Took the whole Brooklyn Bridge.
My choice.
My body.
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 My choice.
Our body.
My choice.
Our body.
My choice.
Our body.
Shut it down.
Fuck
no.
Shut it down.
Shut it down.
Hey, abortion rights have got to stay. Ho ho.
And hey, abortion rights have got to stay. Ho ho.
So that was some of the social media from this morning. The main content of our segment today on the struggle for the right to abortion and to stop the Supreme Court from overturning that right begins with a talk by my co-host Sunsara Taylor, who is an initiator along with others of Rise Up for Abortion Rights, that she gave at Revolution Books Online on May 18th, titled Overturn Roe, Hell No. And that's going to be followed by a discussion we had on the road forward in this battle over the next weeks.
Hello, everybody. Welcome. My name is Michelle, and I'm with the Revolution Club, and I'm also with Rise Up for Abortion Rights. And I want to welcome everybody to this program with Sunsara Taylor, speaking on Overturn Roe, Hell No. And Sunsara Taylor is a co-host of the RNL Revolution Nothing Less show on YouTube. She is a co-initiator of Rise Up for Abortion Rights, and she's a follower of the revolutionary leader, Bob Avakian.
All right, thank you, Michelle. Back in 1964, speaking on Sproul Plaza at the University of California, Berkeley, Mario Savio, a student leader in the free speech movement, made a statement that has rightly become remembered and often quoted since. He said,
"There's a time when the operation of the machine becomes so odious, makes you so sick at heart, that you can't take part. You can't even passively take part. And you've got to put your bodies upon the gears and upon the wheels, upon the levers, upon all the apparatus, and you've got to make it stop. And you've got to indicate to the people who run it, to the people who own it, that unless you're free, the machine will be prevented from working at all."
So I ask you tonight, right now, as the U.S. Supreme Court is on track, the highest court in the land in the most powerful country in the world is on track to decimate women's fundamental right to abortion, within a matter of weeks, to slam the half of humanity that has been born female violently backwards. Is this not such a time? If we let the U.S. Supreme Court go forward and overturn Roe v. Wade, over 20 states immediately ban or severely restrict abortion. And that's just the beginning. More extreme bans are being introduced and passed almost by the day. In Ohio, just a couple weeks ago, Republican Gene Schmidt introduced a near total abortion ban. When asked, what if a 13-year-old girl was raped and became pregnant as a result of the rape? Would this child be forced to have her rapist baby? Gene responded, quote, "It's a shame that it happens, but there's an opportunity for that young woman, no matter how young or old she is, to make a determination about what she's going to do to help that life be a productive human being." An opportunity? These people, these fascist lunatic haters of women, have their hands on the levers of the state. Is this not such a time that is so odious? A time that makes you sick at heart, that you can't take part, that you can't even tacitly take part. In Louisiana, Republican Danny McCormick proposed a law that would give full constitutional rights to a fertilized egg at the moment of conception, full personhood, and would charge a woman who gets an abortion or anybody who assists her with homicide. Arrests, handcuffs, prison, and yes, the death penalty for women who decide they do not want to be pregnant for whatever reason, or maybe just women who have a miscarriage. Is this not such a time where you've got to put your body upon the gears, upon the levers, upon the wheels of the apparatus and prevent it from functioning at all? And let's be clear, banning abortion will affect all women and girls, not just those who are victims of rape or incest, not just those who develop life-threatening complications during their pregnancies. Forcing women to have children against their will forecloses their dreams. It shatters lives. It drives women and traps women in poverty and abuse. This affects poor, impoverished, Black and brown women especially hard, but it affects all women, even women who never become pregnant. It makes them unmistakably aware, and it tells all of society that they are viewed in the eyes of the state, in the eyes of a patriarchal male supremacist society, as nothing more than baby-making machines, that their lives and their humanity doesn't count. So I ask you again, is this not a time for everyone who cares about women and girls, and everyone who cares about justice, to rise up and to indicate to the people who run this society that unless this is stopped, this machine, their society, will be prevented from functioning at all?
So that was Sunsara Taylor from Revolution Books Online on May 18th. Overturn Roe, Hell No was the title of her talk, but Sunsara Taylor, you are here via Zoom on the RNL Revolution Nothing Less show.
That's absolutely right. I'm so happy to be back with you on the show, Andy. It's really good to see you.
Okay, well, you where we cut the speech off, I know that was only about a third of the speech, but we cut it off where you said what we need is a society-wide, sustained, massive, unrelenting, unstoppable struggle from below and from all quarters of society, that it becomes clear to the fascists in the Supreme Court and everywhere else that if they try to go forward with taking away the right to abortion, their society, the whole machine, will be prevented from functioning at all. So I think it'd be important to break that down in terms of what do we mean by that? Well, how does that happen? What does it look like? And then we can get into why could it actually work?
Yeah, I think we need to envision literally millions and millions of people throughout society showing which side they're on, coming into the streets in massive struggle and protest and resistance, but also taking this struggle for women's right to abortion against what the Supreme Court is on track to do into their lives in many different ways, where you could imagine essential workers, bus drivers and hospital workers and people who make society function. If they even stopped work for 19 minutes and 73 seconds for 1973, the year that Roe v. Wade was passed, that would have reverberations across society. If you had artists, beloved singers and actors using their time on the stage to wear green and call on people to stand up for abortion and go into the streets, if you had people displaying this green everywhere, wearing it every day, thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions wearing the green, showing where they stand, flying it out their windows like green flags, or draping major structures or statues or landmarks with green, making a statement with it, you start to have all of society take a stand and show what side they're on. And that's a big vision. There's a lot of other things we can envision, but there's thousands of people who have taken up the call from Rise Up for Abortion Rights to demand that the Supreme Court be stopped from overturning Roe v. Wade. If those thousands, including the very inspiring and furious young people, young women especially, as well as others who've been in the streets, who've been walking out, not only continued to walk out, but increasingly went and marched to the theater districts and challenged the actors and the people in the arts, or came to hospitals at shift change and called on the healthcare workers, the nurses and the doctors and everybody else to stand up and join this struggle for abortion rights, if those who've been involved in the struggle, including the women from Latin America and those with ties to Latin America, where the Green Wave came from, who played a disproportionate role in this struggle, were a part of struggling for other sections of society to join in this fight. And again, the campuses were not just places students were walking out of, as important as that is and as much as that needs to be upheld and continued, but there was massive teach-ins where thousands of students were learning the history, debating the history of this. This became the question that everybody is talking about and learning about and struggling over and taking a stand on. And with how sharply this is posed right now, with the danger that's posed, and everybody, it's going to affect millions. And the truth we're standing on and the thousands who've already stepped forward very fiercely around this, there's ways to work towards realizing that in very short order.
Yeah, I think it's really important. It was making me think back to when I was in high school, and without going into the whole story, we had to walk out from school, and they tried to get us to come back, and we made all kinds of demands, some of which were just, you know, stop telling us to get haircuts and this and that. But it was the 1960s. But
I'm not glad you got over that. That was a correct cultural thing at the time. But I like your haircut, is what I'm trying to say.
Okay, but no, it was actually a struggle over the Vietnam War and over the oppression of Black and Puerto Rican people in New York and racism generally. But one of the demands we had was for a whole day. Actually, asked for a week, as I recall, but we got a day of teach-ins in the school, and we really got into stuff. And it was, and you know, it was very sharply contested by other students, and by there was faculty on one side and the other, and the school was really split. But it was really, it was like the best, you know, some of the best days at school ever. And you know, I think a lot of people, these youth who are out there now, some of them are getting told by their parents, you know, okay, you made your day, we've heard this. You had your day of protest, but now it's time to go back to school and stuff. And I was saying to you earlier that I was thinking of the song Times They Are Changing from Bob Dylan, you know, when he said, come mothers and fathers throughout the land, and don't criticize what you can't understand. Your sons and your daughters are beyond your command. Your old road is rapidly changing. Please get out of the new one if you can't lend your hand. And I think this is important, Stan. These young people can get out and struggle with other people in society about stop playing by the rules of this game, and let's get out and change these rules right now and really fight for this right to abortion to be sustained. And if we really get into the kinds of things you were just speaking about, well, then that's going to create a different situation for the Supreme Court, for the people in Congress, for the politicians, for the whole society to actually take a look at just exactly what they're risking by going ahead with this decision. So I think we should just get into this, you know, one more round, and then we can move on to some other questions.
You know, green graduations are also important. Graduation is coming up, high schools, colleges, coloring this with green. What is this generation's future going to be? What is your stand? What are you about? And it shouldn't be about me, me, me. And the voices coming at the youth and coming at everybody in this society, that even those who say, yeah, abortion's important, but why do you have to risk your future? These are very destructive voices, and we need to defy that and say it's not about me, 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 me. It's about humanity, and it's about the future of all women and girls. And if everybody was to stand up who cares about this and put that ahead of themselves and act together, we could win a future that's better for everybody. It's so important that people defy that right now. So in every level, but the green graduations would really symbolize something. And people, once you get this, you can get creative. I was talking with young people last night who were brainstorming all kinds of wild ideas, daring ideas to go challenge sports figures in major arenas and different ways that we could really shake up society. People need to aim big and not back down on the right that's on our side, that we refuse to see women enslaved by forced motherhood. We refuse to accept this from the government, from the state coming down on people. And if we got that dynamic going, and we've seen this in history, and it's part of why I love that Mario Savio quote that was in that speech and we've been popularizing, is both the stand and the vision and the moral conviction that he puts forward, but it's also a lived experience. It's part of the history of the 60s. This is the kind of struggle that was waged that won the rights to abortion and many other rights that we take for granted today and are now under assault today. And when you get that kind of dynamic going from below, you start to compel politicians and other figures in power to realize they can't appease you anymore with posturing and putting forward legislation that everybody knows is going to fail and not protect abortion rights. They're not going to appease you anymore. They're going to have to come out and try to be in the streets and themselves. And if you get the right dynamic going, that can encourage even more people to come out. And you start to have a dynamic where those in power are compelled to respond to your demands, what you are doing. And people all over the world are watching and inspired by that. And the ruling institutions have to calculate and be worried about losing any shred of legitimacy if they don't make some concessions, if they don't yield to some of what you are insisting upon from below. That's the dynamic. That's the power that the people have when they rise up and they act on that, on right on their side and putting humanity first and putting women first and daring to struggle and really daring to fight to win this one.
Well, I think that's important. This question of losing legitimacy, that does, especially here for the Democrats, they depend on the fact that they represent the more oppressed sections of society. And if they're losing the allegiance of that section of society, that can change things. And in terms of these fascists on the Supreme Court, there too, there's a calculation too. If that court is completely delegitimized, that becomes a contradiction, a problem for the ruling class as a whole, even as there is that fascist element does want to actually rip up the rule of law. That's the content of the Alito draft decision, is that, you know, essentially goes back to, you know, this the 18th century and could be justification for all kinds of really oppressive laws. And in fact, that's where this is heading if those people stay in power. But even there, there's a question of what we do can change things by actually undermining the acquiescence of society that they have. And maybe here we should talk a little bit about, just briefly, about the what's been a very big line program that's been put forward by many different forces, that Roe versus Wade, that's going to go. We know that. So what we really have to do is prepare for elections, the midterm elections in 2022 this year, but also for state legislatures. And we have to work over a period of time to take back what's the majority of people want. And then we have to go do that kind of hard work right now. It is a very big line. It's affecting people. And the young people are now, who are taking to the streets, they're hearing that from experienced movement people saying, oh, don't do this. It's not going to work. Here's a practical approach to this, you know. And as Bob Avakian has said in the past, the politics of the possible are the politics of monstrosity. But maybe you could speak a little bit to this line on elections. And then I want to move back to what you said before about having the interests of all humanity. What motivates you?
Well, first of all, this is something that Bob Avakian goes into very deeply. I cannot commend highly enough the piece that he recently did on the Supreme Court moving to take away the right to abortion and the need to take to the streets and refuse to let this go down. And he takes on dead ends, and this is one of them. And I'll just say briefly here and refer you to the article that the Democratic Party's track record on abortion has been to actually facilitate this fascist assault, to capitulate to it again and again, to demobilize the opposition and the fury of women and others who could be one to stand up and fight for this. They've done great damage. And there is no good reason to believe they would do differently if you rely on them and rely on the elections for them. But on another level, it's just too late. The Supreme Court has not ruled yet. This is not yet law. We have to fight to stop it now. Not wait till it's become law, give up without a fight, and rely on these elections. And if we had the kind of struggle and resistance that we were talking about, the kind that cleaved open all of society and created that kind of legitimacy crisis for the rulers, we actually could back them up. And if we don't succeed, you're going to be in a much stronger place if they do overturn Roe v. Wade. If you built that powerful resistance, this networks of fury and opposition and refusal to let this go down, you're going to be in a stronger position to fight to win that right back, to fight to go forward in many different ways, to fight to help women and others who need abortions to get them in the meantime, you're going to be in a much stronger position. And if you lay down now and rely on the elections and lose this right without fighting like everything you have, throwing everything you have into it, it'll be the opposite. These fascists will be on a tear. They will be unleashed. They will have the initiative. And the people are going to be in less of a fighting mood, more demoralized, more broken, more accommodating to atrocity, which has been far too much the dynamic. This is a fight that needs to be waged now.
Sunsara, I want to come back to some of the ideological questions you spoke about earlier. You know, we'll get to the question of the me versus working in the interests of all of humanity and fighting for the interests of humanity. One form this comes up in, and it came up in something that you were involved in, is I don't want to listen to a white woman tell me about my struggle, because this most disproportionately is going to affect black and brown women. And stay in your lane. This isn't your struggle, or this isn't the struggle of women. This is, if you use the word women, it excludes trans people. So therefore, we just have to talk about people, when the entire movement in opposition to abortion rights was part of a whole patriarchal fascist program of the subordination of women in many different aspects of life, with abortion being the cutting edge and the battering ram of all of that. I want to play an excerpt from an answer to a question that was presented to Bob Avakian in 2017 when he gave a speech that the short title was "The Trump-Pence Regime Must Go." And in this question, he was asked about the student movement. And within this, he spoke about the question that had come up even then in 2017 of identity politics. So let's listen to this, because it has its tremendous relevance to some of what the young people and everybody's running into. Like I said, you ran into it.
Let's talk about something else that's been holding people back, and that's identity politics. The idea that if you're not part of a certain identity group, it's not your place to stand up against the injustices that are directed against that group. Look, our first and most fundamental identity is as part of humanity. That's our first and most fundamental identity. And look, it's one thing to say that people who directly experience oppression have a lot to say about that and should be listened to. That's very true and very important. Let me make an analogy I've made before. If you're in the medical profession and people come to you and you don't even listen to them describe the symptoms or talk about how it's affecting them and what it means for them, you are not going to be a good medical professional. But if you listen to them and then say, well, I wish you luck, I hope you're able to do something about it, it's not my place to have anything to say about it, you're also a terrible medical professional, okay? And the analogy I'm making is, if you don't listen to and seek to learn from people who are directly experiencing something, including a terrible oppression, then you're not going to do good things. If you are arrogant and don't think you have anything to learn about that, or you think you can just tell everybody what to do without really trying to learn, then you're going to do bad things. But it's also very bad if you have the attitude that, well, that's happening to somebody else, I don't like it, I wish them well, but it's not my place to do anything about it. You are also doing very bad things. You're a human being. These are other human beings that are being, subjected to this. If you feel that it's an outrage, you should act. You should do everything you can. You should do everything you can to join with other people to fight against this and with the aim of putting a stop to it. This is, but the, and let's be honest. Let's say you're not part of the identity group. Well, how easy is it for you? You know, how perfect is it for you to have somebody tell you that's not your place to be involved? Oh, well, I'm so glad. You know, I thought I might have to actually sacrifice something. I'm so glad that you're telling me that I don't have to do anything about this, except, you know, listen to you tell me how terrible it is. No. We all should have an attitude that any, you know, anything that's done that's an injustice has to be fought against. And we should all have an attitude of learning from each other and seeking the truth about things. And yes, there is a history in this country. I mean, it's just woven through the entire fabric of this country. You know, of people in the dominant group, in the oppressor group, even well-intentioned ones being condescending to people of the dominated and oppressed group and thinking that they have nothing to learn from them, or that the, you know, that the people in that group, you know, couldn't possibly have any important ideas of their own and so on. This is a real problem, okay? And we should get rid of that. But at the same time, the most fundamental thing is, what is the actual truth of things? What does the evidence actually show? And what should we, as people who care about, you know, what kind of world we live in, and who want a world where people are not unnecessarily suffering and subjected to totally unjustified oppression, what is our responsibility in that context?
Well, Andy, that is such a moving and really still very timely excerpt from BA. It speaks exactly to what so many young people are coming, and other people too, right now. I'm glad that you included that. I think it's important that we are fighting to stop the Supreme Court from doing an atrocity to women, carrying out an atrocity to women. And we need to wage this fight, but there's also a different culture that we need to be forging in the midst of this, going up against all that narrowness, that small-mindedness, the stay in your lane, think about self. I want to show sort of a beginning shoot, a beginning glimmer of some of what needs to be going on a much bigger scale, where these youth who've been part of the walkouts in New York did start going to broader parts of society and challenging others to join in this past weekend. And we need a lot more of this kind of thing. People getting out of their lane and going everywhere and drawing others into this fight. This is them at the steps of the Met Museum in New York.
We're walking out this Thursday to shut the city down.
Look at the crowd.
Every city, every town.
Sunsara, that was great. On your radio show in WPFW in Washington, you had a couple of youth on your radio show. And one thing really struck me, you know, is how the real heart is drummed out of young people in this society in terms of by all this identity politics and look out for yourself. You know, we talked before, parents tell you, because, well, yes, you're right about this, but you really have to look out for yourself. Why do you have to be the one doing this? So you do your schoolwork, do well here, maybe you can do some good for people, but really stay in your lane. And they get told the same thing from activists. They get involved in something like Rise Up for Abortion Rights for the first time, and they run into people in other social movements who say, well, that's not going to work. The Supreme Court, that's a lock-in on that. You should be you shouldn't be doing this anyway. You should be, this is for black women, or this is for trans people, or this is for that. This is, you know, you, why are you doing this, you know? And all this stuff of look out for number one, or look out for this group or that group, and if you're not part of that group, you can't speak. Bob Avakian just talked to some of that. But I was very struck by what a 14-year-old said when you posed the question to her of, well, in New York, at least initially, there'll be abortion rights, so why are you out there on this? And let's just listen to her answer.
It's not about me, is it? Like, I mean, I wouldn't plan on getting pregnant or needing an abortion, but that's not the point. The point isn't whether we have them in our state or where we live. It's the point that every woman or person with a uterus has a right to one. Even, I mean, no matter what, it's not about me. Like, it's the same reason that men would be protesting for this, because even if it's not, like, even if it doesn't specifically affect you, it will affect other people. And if you have basic human empathy and you care about other people, then you should care about this, because it's going to affect countless women and countless people with uteruses, and it's going to make so many people's lives so much worse that, I mean, what, it can't hurt to try and help, to try and do whatever we can, because I know that, I mean, I'm from Kentucky. I don't want, if my friend were to ever get pregnant, I wouldn't want them to have to carry a pregnancy if they didn't want to. I hate the idea that it would, that people don't think that it's right to be fighting for rights that don't directly affect you. Like, I'd go to a BLM protest. I'm not black, but I'd go to one because I care. Because I care about other people's rights. Because I care that we're all equal and we should all have the same fundamental rights no matter where we live. And my question for the people that don't think we should be protesting because it doesn't directly affect us is, why don't you care?
I think a lot of older folks ought to take a listen to what that young 14-year-old said. But you also had on one of the youth organizers who's all of 15 years old, and she quite sharply and eloquently said why she's fighting for this.
A lot of the adults, I mean, in my life even, and I like have very supportive adults around me, but like there's a lot of thought about like why me, or like why your child, like why do you have to skip your math test today? And like I'm like, okay, but like I'm going to these protests. I'm fighting for my future rights and the rights of the next generation, right? Like, if not me, who, and if not now, when? That's another chant that we do. That's just like, just a core value of mine. Like, if I want something to happen, I'm going to do it. And I'm going to do it with everything that I have. As a movement, and as like a predominantly like women's movement, although it absolutely is an issue for trans men and non-binary people. But the anger that we possess that is just not, it's not accepted in other areas of society. Like, we are making a space for that. And that is so powerful. And people don't acknowledge that kind of power. And so we have to acknowledge it in ourselves. And like, our anger is what's going to keep this going, is what's going to stop Roe from being overturned, hopefully. And, you know, we just need more of it. We need more love, like within our communities, within our movement. But anger is really what's going to drive this home, you know, because that's the reason why people are out in the streets, to like show the Supreme Court that we are angry and we can, like, we are going to fight this, you know.
So I think that was a righteous stand from a youth organizer for Rise Up for Abortion Rights. So what is next for the movement to stop the Supreme Court from going ahead with stripping away the right to abortion for women?
So we're really calling on everybody. Look, rise up for abortion rights, and others have been in the streets. We put this question before society in a certain level. It's very important. And thousands of people have been involved in this movement, raising the demand to stop the Supreme Court from overturning Roe v. Wade. Now we need to bring everybody together. Everybody watching this, everybody who was in the streets today for the day of action that Rise Up for Abortion Rights did, everybody who we reached in the streets today, and everybody else we can reach between now and Sunday. We need to get everybody who cares about women and girls' future and justice overall to tune in. We're doing a national organizing summit this Sunday. Online, you can log in anywhere around the country, but you need to clear your time and log in, because we need to come together. We're going to hear from leaders of Rise Up for Abortion Rights who have been leading this and assessing where we're at and forging and planning next steps, so that we can together in this summit and then in the meetings and discussions and the actions that flow out of it that need to go on across this country, really paint this country green, really turn society upside down, really call forth the fury at the future that is being threatened and the joy and the beauty of standing up, and really take this throughout society and fight to win. This is going to be a all hands on deck. Everybody come together. We're going to plot out next steps, and we're going to take this to a higher level, standing on what we've done and really fighting to win. So this Sunday, everybody should tune in. Everybody should be part of it. Spread the word. Get everybody you know to tune in. That's how we're going forward together.
All right. Thanks, Sunsara. This conference is very important. This movement has to be built as broadly as possible, as determined, as sustained, struggled, so that we actually build the kind of movement of hundreds of thousands and millions of people who are determined, as you said, and with the Mario Savio quote, to bring this country to a halt, to defend the right of women to abortion. And this is part of a larger question. If we build this movement in the way it needs to be built, and if people come into it, it's going to pose bigger questions for people about why are things the way they are? Why have they taken this move right now that comes up all the time? Why is there continued police shootings of black and brown people? Why is there this war in Ukraine with the threat of nuclear war? Why is the environment being destroyed? And as they ask these questions, this is part of forging a people, what we call a revolutionary people. And this is absolutely decisive if there's going to be the prospect of a radically different world through an actual revolution, which is what our show is about and for. This is the key task that's gone into in the work, something terrible or something truly emancipating, why this that goes into why this is a rare time when revolution becomes possible. So there's a tremendous import to building this movement as broadly and with as tremendous diversity, including diversity of political opinions. So to the RevComs, we need to throw all the way into this movement and to build it as broad as it should be, while bringing in our full perspective of what is the problem and what is the solution. In a way, I want to tie this particular segment together, where we spent the bulk of our show on this, is with a new article that appears on revcom.us, where Bob Avakian speaks to this kind of woke identity politics and focus on me and my interests and instead of on all of humanity, and ties it together with experience he had as he was becoming a revolutionary and working with the Black Panther Party. And this article is titled, Working with Black Panthers, Working for Revolution, Not Woke Identity Bullshit. So with that, Sunsara, we'll see you soon.
All right, it's been great being here, and let's watch this piece from BA.
Working with Black Panthers, Working for Revolution, Not Woke Identity Bullshit, by Bob Avakian.
I'm going to bring you on now a member of the Peace and Freedom Party who has worked diligently on behalf of Brother Huey. I give you Bob Avakian.
During the years when I worked closely with the Black Panther Party and its leadership, in its revolutionary days in the 1960s, when there were discussions and at times disagreements, they did not say to me, "Who are you, as a white man, to talk about the liberation of black people and revolution? Who are you to disagree with us about this?"
Teach them the need to support the black liberation movement led by the Black Panther Party as a strong fearless voice against American imperialism and to link up with all the people in Vietnam, in China, in Angola, in Latin America, and everywhere else who are standing shoulder to shoulder to drive this vicious beast out of the way and out of the pages of history.
No, things were never based on identity, but on what was true and not true. That's what we were all trying to figure out. This was the case when I first encountered Huey Newton at an African-American cultural program in Oakland. He approached me and said, "Who are you? Socrates?" And this led to a back and forth about revolution. Was it needed? And could this revolution actually be made? The same was true of later discussions I had with Huey, Bobby Seale, Eldridge Cleaver, and other leaders of the Black Panther Party. Always the basis and standard was what was true and not true, never what identity someone was. What we were grappling with was how to radically change the world in an emancipating way, not how to carve out a niche for ourselves, or how to tear down some other people and climb over them to get a better position for ourselves in this terrible world as it is, under the domination of this system of capitalism, imperialism. This is what everyone who cares about the oppressed of the earth and the future of humanity should be grappling with, on the basis of principle and integrity, not the hucksterism and hustling of those seeking to turn identity into capital.